Hello, and a very good morning to you. We are Ashton and Joel Beck, and we're so delighted to welcome you to our Easter Sunday service.
Today is not just any Sunday. It's Easter Sunday, the day that we celebrate and say, I believe in the resurrection of our Lord Jesus. It's the day of hope, renewal, and rejoicing in the amazing love of God.
To our first-time visitors, a special welcome to you. We're thrilled that you've chosen to worship with us today. I believe you will feel the warmth of our community and the love of Christ as you join us online.
One way that you can help us stay connected with you is by filling out a digital Connect card. You can do so on the app or simply by clicking on the link in the description below.
If you have a prayer request or want to find out more about our ministry, please don't hesitate to reach out via our online Connect card. We're here to support you and journey with you in your faith.
Once again, thank you for joining us. We hope to one day see you in person. May this Easter Sunday fill your heart with joy, peace, and the love of our risen Savior. Now let's prepare our hearts and our minds to worship together and experience the power of God's presence in our midst.
He did, our sin. Nobody but Jesus, who rescued me from that grave. Yahweh, Yahweh, who gets the glory and praise. Nobody but Jesus, who pulled me out of that cave. He did, he did, who paid for all of our sin. Nobody but Jesus, who rescued me from that grave. Yahweh, Yahweh, who gets the glory and praise. Nobody but Him. This is our God. This is who He is. He loves us. This is our God. This is what He does. He saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim. This is our God, King Jesus. He bore the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim. This is our God, King Jesus.
Amen. Thankful for the cross today.
Good morning. Welcome to Easter Sunday at West Florida Baptist Church. We are so glad that you have decided to spend this very special holiday with us. This isn't just any holiday. This day represents the very foundation of our faith. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, was born on this earth over 2,000 years ago. He lived a sinless life, died a cruel death at 33, and miraculously rose from the grave 3 days later. So why do we gather in a place called church on a weekly basis? Well, if you look around the room, you'll notice a group of people that are very imperfect. Yet we gather in recognition that our imperfections make His perfection look great. Today, we're going to sing in worship with all of our hearts. We're going to recite scripture that God Himself has penned. We will listen as the truth of God's word is preached. And we will recognize that without the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we would be in darkness. This is church, and there's a place for you. So won't you stand and join us in worship today? Sing with all of your hearts and let God do a work.
The beggars,
Again, he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. We have so much to be thankful for in this life that God's given us, but there's one thing I think that we can give the most thanks for, and that's God sending his son down to earth, dying, but three days later, raising from the grave so that we can spend an eternity with him.
Hallelujah.
Sing with us as we pour out our praise to him in gratitude.
Sing these songs as I
shy on me, lift up your soul. You've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
Come on, loud as you can now.
Come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me, lift up your soul. Cause you've got a lion.
I believe there's only one salvation through the risen Jesus Christ. I can have eternal life by His grace, but that wasn't always the case. You see, I grew up going to church only on Easter. I had never really known why. It was something my family had done without truly knowing Jesus, the Son. When I was 13, I got water baptized because I thought that's how you became saved. But I felt no different. I was still by sin enslaved. My dad was never around, relationship with my mom constantly upside down, substance abuse and depression kept clouding my mind, salvation I could not find. At 18, no one in my family understood, but I knew I had to go or it wasn't gonna end good. So I left, and I met Andrew, who became my safe place, but my anxiety and emptiness would not be effaced. After getting engaged, we started going to church. Now, mind you, I was wearing satanic t-shirts and trying crystals and sage and New Ageism and Buddhism while thinking I was a Christian, all because of my water baptism. It wasn't too long after, while reading Romans 1, God opened my eyes to what I had become, living in vile affliction, shifting glory away from God, searching for salvation everywhere where it's not, because only Jesus' blood is enough. Enough. Enough to save, to redeem me, enough to reconcile with the one and only God, enough to restore my foolish heart, enough, because of His resurrection. Today, being a new creation, having found in Christ my salvation, surrendering to Him without any strife, I believe Jesus Christ is the only way, the truth, and the life.
I believe. I believe by His blood I have been set free. Today there's no other power over me but God's mercy and God's grace. Today I'm not bound by my past mistakes. I'm set free because Christ died in my place. I believe. Before Christ, my life was a mess. My dad went to prison when I was 8. Without a male figure to keep me straight, by the age of 14, drugs and prison were my fate. My addictions only grew. At 18, I was again introduced to a new drug that consumed all of my thoughts and became a new benchmark of how far away I was from God. My life was all about me. I was controlled by addictions, thinking I'm free. Then our daughter was born. It was at that time I began to realize every offer of hope but Christ was lies, and God was wanting to intervene in my life. The very next week, on Sunday, March 15, 2009, I went to church and heard that this man Jesus had died for my sins to set me free. He rose from the grave to make it complete. That's when I believed. With tears in my eyes, hand in hand with my wife, we ran to the altar to surrender to Christ, to receive forgiveness, redemption, and eternal life. I believe in His power, by which today I'm free to live for God and bring glory to Him. I believe.
I believe. I believe in God, my eternal Father, who has cared for me all of my life. From the age of 9 to this day that I'm alive, He's been faithful to His word. I will never be ashamed of Jesus Christ, my Lord. Losing my dad before turning 4 was tough, but God cared for us. We've always had enough. Through our local church, where a message of hellfire and brimstone penetrated my 9-year-old heart to the bone, I surrendered my life for the glory of the Lord. Every time we moved, God used faithful believers to knock on our door. No one in the family usually wanted to go except me. And since no one forbid, I became a bus kid. How could I walk away from God, who has saved me and was like a dad I never had? He provided in my every need. He was the father that would never leave. Through my school and college days, and when my husband betrayed, leaving me with 3 kids alone, God was faithful on His own. I could never be ashamed to proclaim His holy name. I believe He is today the same He was centuries before. I believe His love, care, mercy, and grace are galore. There is no shame calling Him Lord. Don't be naive. The only choice we have with a God like this is to believe.
I believe. I believe in the hope of heaven. I believe in Jesus Christ, that He was born of a virgin and then crucified, and He rose again on the 3rd day, then ascended unto heaven to prepare a place for me to meet with my brother Jaden again. Jaden's time here on earth was quite short compared to many, just over 19 years, but for God it was plenty. Plenty to accomplish His will in Jaden's life, to give us both hope and salvation in Jesus Christ. Plenty to use Him, God's name, to magnify before a painful but temporary goodbye, until we meet in eternity on high. From scriptures, we know Jesus called Himself the resurrection and the life when Lazarus died. Martha believed Him, and so do I. Today, Jaden is with Jesus in the heavens sublime, where I know I will be when it's my time, because of the hope I have in the God Most High. And you can have faith like mine. I believe every word of the scriptures. I believe in the risen King. I believe only hope is in Jesus. I believe, I believe, I believe.
One redemption, one confession. the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life? No, I'll never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life?
The dead 2,000 years ago for your salvation. Okay, my Bible's not over here. Turn to Luke chapter number 24. We are going to read a few verses here. They're going to be on the screen if you don't have your Bible. If you have your phone, you can use it. But Luke chapter number 24. Read with me. Just follow along here down through verse number 19. And then I'm going to have you join with me on a few other verses later on. But just follow along as I read here. Verse number 13 says, "And behold, two of them went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 80 furlongs. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. And it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them, but their eyes were holden that they should not know him." And now look down at verse number 25. Would you join me in these next two verses? "Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?" Now let me read these next couple verses and you'll join me on verse 32. It says, "And it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake and gave to them. And their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight." Join me here on this verse. "And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way, and while he opened to us the scriptures?" You know, just like Jesus appeared to those disciples when he was on the way to Emmaus, just like he sat down with them to eat and revealed himself to them, he'll reveal himself to you if you let him today. He'll open the eyes of your heart. If you walked in here today with a burden on your heart that was heavy, can I tell you, Jesus will lift that burden? Because he's not a dead Savior. He's a risen Savior, and he's alive today. Amen? Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your grace and for your mercy. I thank you for this day. I pray that you bless our pastor as he preaches your word. May our hearts be open to what you have for us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning. He is risen. It is Easter Sunday. We got to do a little bit better than that. He is risen. Awesome, man. It has already been an incredible service this morning. And all I can say is, in Jesus' mighty name, I believe. I believe the words are on our wall here behind us. And you know what that phrase means? It means to logically form a conclusion or an opinion about something. I believe with all my heart that Jesus died and he rose again the third day, and that his resurrection power is alive and at work, because it is the most logical conclusion that you can possibly come to. This morning we heard four powerful testimonies. Weren't those testimonies amazing? Man, we heard from Haley, who talked about being filled with pain and emptiness and experiencing everything that this world had to offer her. We heard from Dan about the fact that he thought he was free, but his freedom actually almost imprisoned him. His freedom almost destroyed his marriage. We heard from Chris, who lost her father at 4. Just try to wrap your mind around that. Lost her father at 4. Her husband betrayed her, abandoned her, left her with 3 children. We heard from Joash, who lost his brother just over a year ago. And do you know what makes Easter so special? Do you know what makes this the amazing day that it is? It is the fact that all 4 of them and hundreds of others that are gathered here today, and myself included, have all come to the logical conclusion that when you believe in the mighty name of Jesus, it changes everything. It's the most logical conclusion that you can come to. You can see the evidence of the power of God in changed lives. Hey, not perfect lives. We're always going to be imperfect. We are sinners, right? But you can see the change. You can see what God does when he gets a hold of a heart. And you yourself can know God personally if you open your eyes to believe the truths that he unveils in this book right here. And if you claim the promises, he will prove himself to you true time and time again. The most logical conclusion you can come to is to believe in our risen Lord and Savior. The title of the message this morning is The Journey to Belief. Our passage tells a story about 2 unfamiliar followers of Jesus who are about to go on a journey from unbelief to belief. It's Sunday. It's the actual literal day that Jesus rose again from the grave about 2,000 years ago. And these men are leaving Jerusalem and they're traveling about 7 or 8 miles to a small village called Emmaus. The journey, probably depending on how fast they walked, would probably take somewhere between 2 to 3 hours. Well, while they are walking, they are talking. And I'm telling you what, these men are reeling. They are reeling. Their whole world had been turned upside down. They believed that Jesus was the Messiah. And then 3 days earlier, he was crucified and put to death on the cross. I mean, their hopes and their dreams had been completely dashed. Now it was the 3rd day, and some of the women that were in their company went to the tomb early. And when they got to the tomb, guess what? It was empty. And they were telling these reports about these 2 men who were angels that were there saying, he's not here because he is risen and he is alive. And some of the other men that were with him ran to the tomb and they discovered that it was empty, just like those ladies said. But what were they going to do with all of this? Nobody had seen Jesus yet, and they hadn't seen him. What were they going to do? Well, look at what happens in verses 15 and 16 of chapter 24. Y'all need to follow along because I'm going to have you help me out, okay? All right, so Luke 24, verse 15, it says this, and it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, everybody help me read this last part of the verse. What does it say? Jesus himself drew near and went with them. They're talking about Jesus and all the events that happened. And guess what? Jesus himself shows up and joins them on their journey. Now look at verse 16. You got to see this. It says, but their eyes were holden that they should not know him. They are literally on a trip with Jesus and they have no idea that it's Jesus who is in their presence. While they are talking with Jesus, there are 3 awesome questions that this passage reveals to us that we need to talk about today and discuss. And so let's just dive right into it. Here's question number 1. Question number 1 is this. Where have you been? Where have you been? Let's look at verses 17 through 19 to see where this question comes from. Look what the Bible says in verse 17. And he said unto them, this is Jesus speaking, what manner of communications are these that ye have one to another as ye walk and are sad? He's like, what in the world are y'all talking about? I mean, he could visibly tell that they were reeling. He said, what's got you so upset? What's got you so sad? Look at how they respond in verse 18. And the one of them whose name was Cleopas answering said unto him. Now, I told you that these disciples of Jesus were unfamiliar disciples. I don't know much about Cleopas, but this I know. He must be from the New York or New Jersey of Israel. Because he is about to respond with a pretty blunt, truthful answer. I mean, he's just going to lay it out on the line, all right? So look what he says. And the one of them whose name was Cleopas answering said unto him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem and hast not known the things which are come to pass there in these days? Like, where in the world have you been? Have you been living under a rock? I could just imagine Jesus looking back at him and being like, actually, it was a huge stone. That's where I've been. I mean, they're sitting there and they're just like, they're just perplexed. How could you not know what is happening and what is transpiring? Well, Jesus, he's not playing along with them, but he asks another question because he's trying to bring to light the things that they already know inside. And he says in verse 19, and he said unto them, what things? And these men, they go on. I could read verses 19 through 24, but I want to tell you, these men, they go on and they say, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, he was a prophet, mighty in word and in deed before God and all men. But our chief priests and our rulers, men, they have delivered him and condemned him to death, and they crucified him, and we're devastated because we truly believe that he was the Messiah, that he was going to be the one to redeem us from the land, but now he's dead. But guess what? Today's the third day. It's the third day, and some women from our company, they went to the tomb, and they found that his body was not there, and they said that there were some angels there that told him that he was alive, and other people went to check, and when they got to the tomb, it was empty. Jesus is not there. What in the world are we supposed to do with this? And then, by the way, where have you been? How do you not know any of these things that have happened concerning all the things that have taken place in Jerusalem? They're talking to Jesus. Jesus didn't reply with this because they already knew it and it was going to eventually be revealed. But I could hear Seer Jesus saying, listen, I have always been. I am the creator of heaven and earth. I am your creator. Heaven is my home where I'm worshipped and adored, where I spend time with all of the angels. But about 33 years ago, I left heaven and I humbled myself and I became a man. And I was born in Bethlehem in a stable, and they laid me in a manger. I've lived a humble life the past 2.5 years. I've been in Galilee, and I've been performing miracles, and I've been opening up the keys and the truth to God's word, and I have proven over and over again that I am who I say I am. But more recently, in just the past few days, I was in the Garden of Gethsemane, and I was praying in agony to my Father, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. If there's any other way, nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And I get up and I go to leave the garden, and I'm met there by Judas, one of my closest followers, one of my closest disciples, and he betrays me with a kiss. Then I'm falsely accused. I've been beaten. I've been spit upon. I've had the beard plucked out of my face. I've been mocked and made fun of. I've had a crown of thorns shoved into my head. They took a whip, a leather whip that was shredded at the end that had sharp pieces of glass on it. They took leather balls and they took that whip 39 times and they literally ripped my back to smithereens. Then they forced me to carry my cross to Golgotha. They laid me down on that splintery wooden cross, and they took great big nails, and they drove them into my hands, and they took nails, and they drove them into my feet, and then they stood that cross up, and it thudded into the ground, and for 6 hours, I hung on that cross in excruciating pain and agony. But you know what the worst part was? I became sin. A holy, righteous God. I became sin, and my Father turned his back on me, and I cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And then I gave up the ghost. I cried out, it is finished, and I breathed my last breath, and they took me off the cross, and they prepared my body, and they laid me in a cold, dark, borrowed tomb. But just this morning, the Holy Spirit of God showed up. Just this morning, he breathed life back into my body and into my soul, and death could not hold me, and the grave could not keep me, and that stone was rolled away, and I walked out of that grave, and I am here right now with you. That's where I've been. Will you praise the Lord this morning? I believe with all my heart that Jesus died. I believe that Jesus died. I believe that whenever we are reeling and desperately searching for answers, and listen, I don't know you this morning. I don't know your background. I don't know what you've gone through. I don't know what you've experienced. But I know who does. I know that God does. I'm sure that in this room, there's probably some people in here that have gone through horrific things, and you've even been at that point in your life where you're saying, God, if you're real, how could this have happened? And where were you when I really needed you in the deepest, darkest moments? Can I tell you this, that Jesus, even when you're crying out and questioning him, that he is there, he is right by your side. And if you could just open up your eyes, you would see his arms extended to you, and you would see the nail scars in his hands, and he would say, that's where I've been. I died the death that you deserve to die. He took my place. He was where I deserved to be. Do you understand about these men? These men knew all about Jesus with their heads, but they didn't get it. What we need, more than we need someone to fix our problems, more than we need someone to heal us, more than we need financial prosperity or a blessed life, more than we need any of those things, we need a Savior. Because we're sinners. If you come here today and you are broken, you are in the right crowd. This is a room that's filled with broken, imperfect people. Don't let the clothes fool you. I think I look pretty good today. My wife got me Audrey. Just kidding. Although I do think I look pretty good. No, just kidding. Anyway, listen, don't let that fool you. There's not a facade. I hope that there's never a facade that believers put across. We are broken sinners in desperate need of the grace and mercy of God. And Jesus Christ, he died because the punishment for my sin was death and going to church and having a water baptism like Haley talked about and doing good things to your neighbors and hoping that your good outweighs your bad when it's all said and done. Those things will never save you. Only what Jesus Christ did for you on the cross, only that will save you. Somebody had to pay my penalty. Somebody had to take my place. And that person was Jesus. I believe Jesus died. The second question that I want to look at this morning is this. Wasn't this necessary? Wasn't this necessary? Look how Jesus responds to these two men after they said all these things. Look at verse 25. Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? That's what he's saying. Wasn't this necessary? Wasn't it necessary for Christ to suffer and die so that he could enter into his glory? And then look at verse 27. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. You want to talk about a master class of mesmerizing teaching that would hold your attention and your mind would not even wander for a single second. Imagine walking and spending 2 to 3 hours with Jesus where he opens up the Old Testament and he tells you all about how it points to him. That's what happened. I can imagine he probably went all the way back to the garden and he looked at those guys and he said, remember the garden? What happened in the garden with Adam and Eve? They sinned, right? God told them not to eat of the forbidden fruit, and they ate the forbidden fruit, and they sinned, and because they sinned, death passed upon all men. And remember why they sinned? Because there was a serpent that came along, and that serpent tempted them, and that serpent got them to not have faith in God and to believe that God was trying to hold back good things from them, and they ate of the forbidden fruit. Well, remember what God told that serpent? Remember when he came along and he said, hey, the rest of your life, you're going to crawl around on your belly. I can even imagine him saying this. And by the way, how do you kill a snake? What's the best way to get rid of a snake? Man, you take your heel and you shove that thing right down on his head and you stomp until there is no more life left in that snake. And can I tell you, serpent, one day there's going to be a seed that's going to come from the seed of a woman, and he's going to be a man, and he's going to be the innocent, perfect, sinless sacrifice, the Lamb of God, and he's going to go to a cross, and yes, sin is going to bruise him, but he's going to rise again one day. And when he does, Satan, you are done. You are finished. It is over. Death has no more hold. Death has no more power. That's only 3 chapters into the Old Testament. I mean, that's just getting warmed up. I could sit here this morning, We could walk through the entire Old Testament. We could talk about the promises God made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We could talk about the Exodus and the Passover lamb and the parting of the Red Sea. We could talk about the manna that he fed them with every single day. We could talk about the pillar of fire by night and the cloud by day. We could talk about the tabernacle, the temple, the sacrifice, the feast. We could talk about the kingdom of David and the promise that God made to him that one day there would be a man that would come from his seed that would rule and reign on his throne forever. We could talk about how God's children, in spite of his goodness, failed him and sinned and messed up, and Jerusalem got destroyed and the temple got destroyed and they got led away into Babylonian captivity. We could talk about how the fact that God miraculously sent them back into the land and they rebuilt the walls and they rebuilt the temple, and Jesus Christ himself was in that temple just a few days earlier teaching and preaching. I could tell you the entire Old Testament points to Jesus Christ, because it does. The Old Testament sets up the fact that Jesus is a better king. He sets up the fact that there are a blessed people. He sets up the fact that there is a broader land that flows with milk and honey and promises and the goodness of God galore. I believe it was necessary for him to die so that he could rise again from the grave, so that he could enter into his glory, so that you and I can enter into his glory and spend all of eternity forever with God. I believe Jesus is alive. I believe Jesus is alive. Listen, do you understand this morning that Jesus is the better king? That all of you that put your faith and trust in Jesus, we are a blessed people. Do you understand that the kingdom of heaven is the promised land? Joash was exactly right. There's coming a day when he's going to see his brother again. There's coming a day where there's going to be no more sickness, sorrow, pain, tears, crying. He's going to make all things new. There's coming a day where the best part about it all is we get to be in the presence of Jesus, where there's fullness of joy and pleasure forevermore. I believe Jesus is alive. And you know the best part? We don't have to wait. That new life begins now. Now, again, I'm not promising you that if you put your faith in Jesus, the prosperity gospel, you're going to be wealthy and wise, and man, you're going to get bigger houses and lands. I'm not promising you that you're never going to have to go through cancer. I'm not promising you that you're not tragically going to lose your brother out of the middle of nowhere. No, there is pain and suffering in this life, but I am promising you this. It doesn't matter where you find yourself. His resurrection power is enough. It's enough. It's enough to set you free from fear, from depression, from anxiety. It's enough to satisfy and fulfill the longings in your heart. I promise you this, Jesus will never let you down. He's a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. He's a father that will be faithful. He will never fail you. He will never leave you. He's everything that you're searching for. He's everything that you're looking for. I believe that he is alive, and he wants you, and he wants a relationship with you, and he wants to do an incredible work of transformation in your life. And the last question is this: did not our heart burn? They reached the end of their journey. Again, 2 to 3 hours with Jesus, opening up the scriptures, and Jesus, he starts saying goodbye. He's going to continue on, and these men, they don't want this to stop. They don't even know it's Jesus, but they know that something's happening inside of their heart, so they beg him. They're like, you can't go on. You need to eat. Come on in and have dinner with us. So you know what Jesus does? He goes into the house. He sits down. The Bible tells us that he takes the bread and he blessed it. Maybe the moment of faith started coming when he started praying. Maybe the way that he said, Father, there was something so genuine and real and authentic about it. Maybe it's the words that he said, thank you for this bread, which gives us the strength that we need. Thank you for the way you sustain us in life. Thank you for the way that you've provided every single thing that we need. Amen. And he opens up his eyes and he breaks the bread and he hands it out like this, and instantly their eyes were opened. It was Jesus right there in front of them, and instantly he was gone. Now, how many of you believe that was a meal unlike any other meal that you'd ever experience in your life? Look at how they respond. They respond in a pretty incredible way in verse 32. The Bible says, and they said one to another, what is that next phrase right there? Read it out loud with me. Did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way and while he opened to us the scriptures? Did not our hearts, those questions, the answers that we were looking for, he answered them all. The Bible is true. Jesus is who he said he is. And then their eyes were opened and they believed. Did not our hearts burn? Can I tell you this morning? The last practical application is this. I believe. And when I believe, I see. If you want to see, you have to believe. And the moment that you believe, your eyes will be opened and you will see life from a brand new perspective and in a whole new way. Hey, did not your heart burn this morning when you heard those testimonies? Man, my heart was burning inside of me at the goodness and mercy and grace of God, how it speaks to wherever you find yourself in life. Did your heart burn today as you thought about the pain and the suffering on the cross, as his body was broken and his blood was shed, as he paid my sin penalty? Does your heart burn when you think about Jesus and that sacrifice that he paid for you? And does your heart burn this morning with hope as you think about all the possibilities of your new life in him? There are endless possibilities. Does your heart burn with hope and desire to lift up the name of Jesus and to see him and to believe in him and to watch him transform whatever situation you find yourself in? Is your heart burning right now? Because you know that you are a sinner and you know that you need a Savior. Do you see Jesus as the bread of life? See, there's so many people in this world that know all there is to know about Jesus. They got a lot of head knowledge. And when you came in this morning, this was just bread. How often do we... I like bread. I like to have bread as part of my meal. Part of my meal. I enjoy it. I think most people here do enjoy it. Bread's a huge part of our lives, but so often it's just a part of our life. It's not our life. It's not what sustains us. And this morning, you may have fond feelings of Jesus. You may think he's a pretty good man, a great teacher, but is he your personal Lord and Savior? Have your eyes been open to the fact that he is the very bread of life? He is the source of life, the source of strength. God provided everything that you need in a Savior and in a Lord through his Son, Jesus Christ, and what he did for you on the cross. Do you see him as the bread of life in your only way? Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Nobody's looking around this morning. Every single week we ask, I believe, the most important question that anybody will ever ask you at any given point in your life, and it's this: do you know for sure that you have a relationship with God? Do you know for sure that you have a relationship with God? You see, we talked all about it this morning. We are sinners. I probably don't have to convince you about that today. And by the way, if you're here this morning and you know you're a sinner and you're feeling maybe ashamed or broken, listen, you are in the right place. You are in a room filled with people that know exactly how you feel, that have been there, that still find themselves there on a regular basis. You've come to the right place. Man, when I think about my brokenness, even as a pastor, I still struggle. The things that I want to do, I don't do. The things that I don't want to do, I do. I find myself in this battle over and over and over again because I'm a sinner and I'm broken. And because of our sin, we deserve death. And we talked about that this morning. But here's what has to happen. You don't just have to recognize you're a sinner. And you don't have to try to fix yourself. You have to, when you realize that you are a sinner, you have to look to Jesus and realize that he paid for your sin on the cross. And the only way to be saved is to believe that his death is the only way. And by the way, just knowing that in your head, when we're born into this world, we're born going away from God. We're not born on our way to heaven. We're born sinners. We're born lost. There's a gap between us and God. The Bible says that we got to repent. We've got to turn. We've got to stop going our own way in our own direction. We've got to turn and we've got to look to Jesus and we've got to believe on the Lord Jesus that he died and that he's my only way of life and he's my only way of salvation. So do you remember that time when everything clicked and it made sense and you believed in your heart that Jesus was your Savior and you became a new creation in Christ, a new person? Is there anybody here this morning that would slip their hand up and say, Pastor Mike, I don't know for sure that Jesus is my Savior. I don't remember that time where it really clicked, and I don't have a defining moment where I really put my faith and trust in. I believed on him as my Savior, but I want that to change today. I want to believe in Jesus. Would you pray for me? Is there anybody that would slip their hand up this morning and say, Pastor Mike, pray for me? Anybody at all? This is the most important decision you could ever make in your life. Is your heart burning inside of you right now? Something inside of you telling you that, hey, there's something off. I don't have hope. I don't have confidence that when I die, heaven's my home. If that's you this morning and your heart's burning, I beg of you, believe in Jesus. See him as who he is. Is there anybody this morning that would slip their hand up? Anybody at all? I need to be saved. I need to believe. Father, I pray that you would continue to move and work in this place. And for those that don't know you as their Lord and Savior, God, I pray that you would open their eyes. Help them to think about what they heard today. But I pray that you wouldn't leave them alone until they are ready to take that step and put their faith and trust in you. And they're ready to have a testimony of salvation. They're ready to experience the new life that you have waiting for them. Lord, I pray that you would continue to draw people to yourself and save people. For all of us who do believe, God, I pray that you never stop burning inside of our hearts. I pray that we would burn every time we think about our sin and every time we think about the price you paid for us on Calvary. Lord, I pray that our hearts would burn with the hope and the possibilities of the new life that we have in Christ. Lord, I pray that our hearts would burn to share the good news, the greatest news, that Jesus is alive. He's the answer. He's the hope of the world. He's what everybody's looking for and searching for. God, burn inside of us. Help this world to see you. And we'll thank you and we'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to stand up in just a minute. I want you to know that we have members of prayer teams at the end of every single aisle. We're going to sing a song as we close our service. Man, if you came with a burden this morning, if you don't know for sure that Jesus is your Savior, let us help you today. While we sing, slip out of your aisle. Go see one of these prayer team members. Even at the end of the service, they'll still be available for you to go talk to. Let somebody pray with you. Let somebody help you today if you got a burden. Let's all stand to our feet and let's sing Living Hope as we close our service today. I think we're just getting warmed up. I think we got to go back and do verse 3. It's Easter Sunday. He is risen. He is risen. Let's do that last verse one more time and sing it with every ounce of your heart. All right, here we go.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has opened on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
And all God's people said, amen. Hey, you don't even have to be seated today. We just got a couple quick announcements for you. If you are visiting with us today, can I tell you how happy we are to have you here? On your way in, you may have received a Connect card. If you did not, that's okay. There's one in the seat in front of you. You can text welcome to the number that's on the screen. Or you can just simply do what we'd really love for you to do, and that's walk over here to the Next Steps wall to Trey. We have a special gift that we'd love to give to you, but it is our privilege to have you here today. And if you joined us online, thank you so much for joining us today for our Easter services. You can connect with us by clicking on the link that's in the description, but thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. I also wanted to make you aware that on your way out front, there is a photo booth that's set up so you can get some family pictures. We'll have somebody out there to even help you with that. And there's some information about how you can share some of the Easter graphics, because we want the world to know that our Savior is alive. Will you praise the Lord again this morning? One more time. Pastor Chuck, you come.
Hey, thank you, Pastor Mike, for that message. Hey, real quick, two announcements. At the end of the service, our prayer team will move from the back up here to the front. So if you didn't get an opportunity to come, or I know it's kind of scary to step up, but if you're saying, hey, I'd like to just pray, or hey, I got something going on in my life, or hey, I'm ready to take that step, I want God in my life, they'll be down here up in the front. And then we have our starting point class. So for those of you that are new, you're thinking, what is a starting point class? It's an opportunity to get to know our pastor and his wife and our church. It'll be starting on April 14th. It goes 3 Sunday nights at 5 p.m. If you're saying, hey, I just want to learn, I just want to get to know the church and Pastor Mike, then come and see me over there at the Next Steps wall. I'll have an iPad and I can sign you up right there. So thank you guys for coming. I'm going to go ahead and pray and then we'll get out of here. Lord, I just want to come to you right now. I want to thank you and praise you for this time. I thank you for each and every one that is here. Just bless us as we go our way, Lord. And again, I thank you for this time. Thank you, Pastor Mike. Can you hear me pray? Amen. Have a good day.